alone, or you go to a place alone where you can spend time with the Father. And how awesome that is to get in that place with the Lord, that you just spend time with Him and make you a place to pray. I was talking with a young man this afternoon, and I was telling him, I said, you know, I sneak down there to the barn quite often, and Carrie thinks I'm fooling with the goats and the chickens and chasing the groundhogs or whatever, but there's a lot of times I go down there and I just sit and pray. Yeah. You know, I feel like I got to get away for a few minutes, and I go down there and I sit down and begin to pray and just talk to Jesus, and just like He's right there in the room with me. You know, Jesus gave an example of how we need to pray and how we need to talk to the Father. But there's many times I just sit down and I said, well, Father, I just need to talk to you. Yeah. I need to spend a few minutes with you. Yeah. You got time for me? And it never fails that when I just ask you, have you got time for me? It's just like the Holy Ghost just surrounds that place.
Yeah. Amen. Yeah.
He built a barrier.
Come on.
Devil stuck outside. He didn't even see in the wind. Maybe that's the reason the Lord let them fog up so bad you can't see in or out. But I get in there and get to pray, and the devil can't look in, he can't peek through the cracks in the board. The Holy Ghost just enveloped us right there, and me and the Father through the Son, we having a conversation, and I can just sit there and just pour my heart out to God, and I can just let the power of God just begin to overwhelm me. I've shared with Carrie many times, I was, if you start hearing a racket coming out of that barn, screaming and hollering or whatever, stuff being thrown around, I said, I'm either having a nervous breakdown or I'm having a Holy Ghost meeting, one or two. I said, but don't worry about it. Either way, I'm going to come out of there eventually. But I'm going to tell you what, the world wants you to have that nervous breakdown. The world wants you to fall apart, amen, and just give up on God. But I'm going to tell you, you got to get in that secret place with God for a little while and let the Holy Ghost overwhelm you for a while. Let the power of the Almighty God come down right where you're standing for a while and just let Him overwhelm you and engulf you. And when you get done shouting and praising and glorifying God, you'll come out of that secret place that God said, I'll reward you openly.
Yeah.
He said, I'll reward you openly.
Praise
amen. I want to give a kick for Sunday school real quick. If you don't come to Sunday school, you're missing a good time in the Lord.
Amen.
For those of you that don't attend Sunday school, in this class in here or any of the Sunday school classes, you know, bring your children, your grandchildren, your nieces, your nephews, get them to come. Because Sunday school is so important. It's so important. And we have a real good time in here.
Yes, amen.
Amen. Amen. We've had several testify healings. Sister Donna went to the doctor, eye doctor this week, come back with a good report that things are improving.
Thank
God. Amen. We've had several testify against people, and God just moving in mighty ways. So just come and be with us.
Yes.
Come and be with us. And we're not one of these Sunday school classes that you sit there and read word for word, or you need to take notes. By the time we get out of here, you're going to wound up tight. Amen. I don't know how Brother Richard gets preaching Sunday morning, and Brother Jason gets preaching Sunday morning. How do we get done? I'm going to tell you something. If you have your Bible, turn with me to Matthew chapter 11. I want to share with you there just for a little while if I could. But as you're looking there, I want to open up the business a little bit. Jesus is in a place that he's been ministering and sharing and teaching. And if you go back and read the first part of chapter 11, he's talking about the disciples of John the Baptist have come from John, and they're asking the question that John wants to know the answer. Are you the one we're looking for, or should we seek after another? And Jesus just continues on with his ministry of healing people. He's opening blinded eyes. He's blessing people left and right. And he's telling the disciples of God, go back and tell John everything you've seen and everything you've heard. And just to reassure John that he knows who he's looking at. Amen? But then if you get on about verse 20, Jesus starts, he kind of changes direction with what he's talking about. Starts out with, whoa. In other words, look out. Be careful. He's talking about the people that are all around when he's ministering. They're all around while he's preaching the good news of the Father. He's sharing the glory of his Father. He's trying to express who he is, and without just coming right out and saying, I'm the Messiah, I'm the Christ, I'm the one you're supposed to be looking for all these generations. It's in the law, and I'm here to fulfill. the very point today, I'm just upset with all the unbelief. I'm upset with all the unbelief. There's so much unbelief surrounds us every day. Look in verse 25 of chapter 11. Jesus even said, I thank thee, O Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because thou hast hid these things from the wise and the prudent. But you've revealed them unto babes. He's took the opportunity to let us know that with a childlike faith, we've received what he said. We've received his message. We know who Jesus is. How many knows who Jesus is?
Amen.
And you travel with him every day, you walk with him every day, you live with him every day, and you enjoy his presence every day. And that's what he's wanting us to do, just to enjoy that and be a part of it. As Brother Richard shares many times, you know, we're not it, but we're part of it. I shared that the other day. We were having a work. Carrie knows this for a fact, and Bill knows this for a fact. I went to work Thursday morning at 8 o'clock. I got home about 8 o'clock Friday night, except long enough to come home, take a shower, change clothes, and go right back to work. And, you know, so I pulled about 38 hours straight. And just going home. And somewhere during the wee hours of the morning, somebody asked me, said, how are we going to make it? How are we going to do it? How can you keep going? I said, it's just the grace of God.
Yeah.
I said, but you know what? I said, I'm not it. I can't do it all. I said, I've got help.
Right.
I said, but I'm part of it. And my buddy that was with me all night long, he looked at me and smiled. He said, yeah, we're a part of it, ain't we? I said, if they only understood what I was talking about. I said, do you? He said, I understand. He said, it's only by the grace of God that we can keep going. Amen, because the body's not in hell. But the body, the brain keeps telling the body, just keep going, just keep going, just keep going. But I want to share with you, if I could, on a thought, the secret of rest. He said there in verse 25, he said, I'm glad that you hid these things from the wise and prudent, but you revealed them unto babes. If you would stand for the reading of his word, in verse 28 is where I want to start. Very familiar verse of scripture. He said, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. He said, take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly of heart, and ye shall find rest for your soul. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. Let's look into this tonight as the secret of rest. The secret of rest. Let's pray together. Father, we love you and we pray and we thank you for the privilege and opportunity to be in your house one more time. I'm here, Lord, not to try to make a show, not to try to, Lord, to build a person up, but to build up Jesus Christ and the power of his word through the Father, and Lord, the power of the Holy Ghost, the anointing, the stirring. I pray you stir the gift in your servant. Lord, bring your word tonight, Lord, in demonstration of power of the Spirit. Father, bless your people to stir our hearts. Father, that we may know, that we may learn, that we may gain, Lord, the secret of rest in our lives each and every day. Lord, that we're so just surrounded by turmoil that God, only you can give us that rest that we need. Hallelujah. Father, we just want to give you the glory and the praise and the honor for everything is done for you and by you and for your glory. Amen. And we honor you tonight in Jesus' lovely name. Amen.
Amen.
Realizing who we are. In Matthew 28:29-30, he's talking about there when he goes through this spiel about, you know, the people that's not willing to receive the word of the Lord, not willing to receive Jesus as who he is. And we've all run into these situations. We've all been there. We talked about it in Sunday school this morning, son, that we have to deal with those that want to fight against God. They want to fight against those that are trying to work for God. 9 times out of 10, it's the religious crowd. That's what the Sunday school lesson is talking about. It's the religious crowd that want to fight against God. They want to fight against the people of God, those that are trying to share the gospel, those that are trying to encourage, amen, those that need encouraging. Amen? I got on Brother Richard Keys last Sunday, and he said something about the Tennessee football game. I said, well, did you watch the game? He said, it broke my heart. He said, I just turned it off and went outside. I said, you mean you didn't even support it? I'm picking on Richard because I called him way. I done him last week. I need to apologize because I got a little mean with him. But I told him the truth. I said, you mean you didn't sit there and support your team? Well, no, it gets so bad. He said, I just felt so bad about it. He said, I just went outside. Didn't even want to watch it. I said, you know, supporting your favorite team is like serving Jesus. Got his attention then. I said, my fault, your fault, nobody's fault, good, bad, indifferent, and no matter win, lose, or draw. I said, do you give up on Jesus? Or do you stay on his team? Do you stay by his side? Do you walk with him no matter what? I said, should you not do your favorite football team the same way? Those players out there working hard and you turn your back on them by turning the television off. Shouldn't you support your favorite team?
No.
Shame on
you.
You gotta be willing to support your favorite team. All through high school, the school I went to, and they had good games, they had bad games, but I was there every Friday night. I backed them up every game. I tell the players, hey, you did a good job. They might have lost terribly, but I tell them, you gave it your best effort. You didn't give up. Next thing I know, I just walked away. Next thing I know, Brother Richard walked up to me and he grabbed me and he hugged me. He said, you're the best encourager I believe I ever met. But I'm going to tell you something tonight, church. We're going to be in situations where we think we're losing, where we think we're going to go down. But I'm going to tell you, the power of the Holy Ghost is going to hold you up and support you and sustain you, and you're still going to be a winner. Amen? Yes. The Word says that we're more than conquerors through Christ Jesus our Lord, that even no matter what the weapon that's formed, we shall prosper. But we got to be willing to hold on. We got to be willing to keep on fighting. Even Jesus got discouraged when the crowd didn't want to believe, when the crowd didn't want to get involved, when they didn't want to receive. And you're going to run into that situation that at times that you're sharing the love of God, you're trying to encourage somebody, they'll turn their back on you, they don't want to listen to you, they'll try to rebuke everything you say and some kind of rebuttal in such a way that they're just trying to tear apart your encouragement. And you are going to get discouraged. You're going to get a little bit down and out. Things are going to happen in your life. Amen. Look at Sister Barry back here. She's going through a physical trial that most of us would have done laid down and quit. I ain't going to church. I don't feel like it. I'm going to just stay here and rest. Look where she's at. She's in the house.
Amen.
Amen. She's letting the devil know I ain't giving up.
Amen.
Because God ain't give up.
That's right.
God's going to heal her. I believe that. But we get in a situation in our life sometimes, and even Jesus, sometimes we just need to take a break. Sometimes we need a break. Sometimes we need that little bit of rest. If you read in verse 28, Jesus said, come unto me. That's a personal invitation to him that will receive the invitation. Nobody's ever got an invitation in the mail and at the bottom of it said RSVP, reservation. Whatever that means. Reservation. That's what Gilligan said it was. You know. I think it's to respond.
Yeah. So we don't have any hot dogs to buy.
Right. You go into a wedding, you don't have any hot dogs to buy. That's not a hot dog in a wedding. Serve about everything else. Well, I don't have a lot of them. We'll buy Dijon mustard. That's so fancy.
Very coupon.
Very coupon. We're mad. No, personal invitation. Jesus sent you a personal invitation. He handled it. The Holy Ghost brought it too. Amen. How many times can you remember that the Holy Ghost just speak to you in your spirit? Come on. Come to me. refuse that call? How many times did we refuse the answer to that invitation? But there came a day that when you said finally in your spirit that, yes, I will receive this invitation and I will go unto the Lord. He said, come unto me. He didn't say go searching out in the world. He didn't say go down here and see Dr. So-and-so. He didn't say go over here to this drugstore and buy this specific medication or start eating this kind of food. But I'm going to tell you what he told you to do. He said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. He said, come and dine. Amen. Because I got the food that you need. I got the drink that you need. And it's going to change your life forever. I share a funny thought many times with people, and I ask them the question. I say, can you tell me the difference between a wedding and a funeral? When you ask that question to people, people will give you the strangest looks. And it's amazing some of the answers you might get. Some, I don't think I can repeat them in front of them. But some people look at you and say, well, I don't know what the difference is. I said, there is no difference. What? There's no difference between a wedding and a funeral? I said, absolutely not. Jesus didn't say nothing in the Word how to do a wedding. He didn't say nothing about how to do a funeral. Did he? There's nowhere in the New Testament talks about how to do either one. But the bottom line is, somebody's life is fixing to change forever. And that's the bottom line. Jesus said, come. Let me make a change in your life. He said, come unto me, all of you that labor. All of you that toil. All of you that work hard. And I'm not talking about just physically working hard. Some people's jobs do different things. Some sit in front of a computer or at a desk all day. It may not physically demand, but it's mentally and spiritually demanding. Some of us have to go out with a pick and a shovel all day long. It's physically demanding. It's spiritually demanding. It is mentally demanding. How hard is it to dig a ditch? You've got to dig it the right way. Trust me, I know. I've been doing it for about 40, almost 40 years. Amen. And I finally learned how to do it the right way. Now I'm starting to teach other people how to do it. And that's wonderful. But everything you do, you need to share what you know. Be willing to share what God's blessed you with. But he said, come unto me, all you that labor, all of us that toil, all of us that work hard. And it doesn't matter if you're doing it physically on a job for a secular job, or if you're in the church working, you're pastoring, you're teaching, you're singing, you're making music, you're sharing, you're evangelizing, no matter what you're doing, it's all hard work. You look at me like, why are you doing that? Hey, Jesus said, come, all that labor. If you put effort into it, it's labor. Is it not? It's labor. If you're washing dishes, it's labor. If you're vacuuming the floor, it's labor. Whatever you do, it's labor intensive. And Jesus is wanting us to know that if it fatigues you, if it takes a toll on your body, and on your mind, and on your spirit, he's saying come. He's saying come. The world wants you to get out and do all this crazy stuff to try to relax and unwind and all that. Hey, Jesus said, come to me, all you that labor and are heavy laden. The load, the heavy laden, the load carriers, the burden bearers. We look around this room and you can look at yourself in the mirror. Am I a burden bearer? Am I a load carrier? Am I one that can pick it up and carry on with it and without breaking down? What's the old saying? The straw that broke the camel's back? After a while, you can't put but so much on a beast of burden, and that beast of burden can't take another step. And I know everyone sitting in this room tonight, you've been at that place in your life, both physically, both mentally, both spiritually, that you've been in that place. God, I can't go no farther. I can't take any more. You're to the point that you can't lift one foot off the ground and take a step. You can't make a thought that makes any sense. You can't speak a word that even is able to encourage anybody, including yourself. He's saying, come.
come to me. He said, I'll give you rest. He said, I'll give you rest. Those of you who served in the military, you put that old heavy backpack on and all that equipment. Boy, you just walking, marching, running, all that good stuff. And after a while, you get to the point, I don't know if I can take another step. But there's somebody that are going to encourage you if it ain't nobody but your drill instructor. Come on, one more step. Do it for your country. Amen. Jesus said, take one more step for me. Just one more step. That may be the step when somebody reaches and gets a hold of your burden. Takes the load off of it. I used to do a lot of backpacking in the mountains. I'd carry loads on my back that weighed more than I did. And it was so pleasurable when somebody walked up behind you and said, if you'll unbuckle your belt, I'll help you. Pop that belt loose, and all of a sudden, they'd lift that pack up off of you. And you figure, man, if you didn't grab a hold of a tree, you're going to float away. That's how life can feel. That's the way it is with God. He said, come unto me, all ye that labor. You've toiled down to the point that you can't toil anymore. He said, all you that are heavy burden, he said, I'll give you rest. I'll take that load off of you, and I'll hang on to it. He's not telling us he's going to hold it for a little while, but he said, I'll hang on to it. Amen? He's going to hold that load for you. He's going to bear that burden for you because he's the kind of God that wants to give you that blessing. He said, I'll give you that rest to all those that are laboring, all that are, those that are burden-bearing, all those that are so distressed, all them that are sick in body, sick in their mind, sick in their spirit, that the enemy is trying to destroy. You're tired and you're weary. Tired and weary. I just don't know if I can go another mile. I don't know if I can just take another step. Have you ever been that way? Physically, I'm going to ask you physically, you just been so tired that you couldn't go another step. You just didn't know how you're going to get in the door. But all of a sudden, it seemed like when the door opened up and you saw home, it just seemed like it was a burst of energy. Get you them one or two or three steps up there in the door. And you make it to your favorite chair or make it to the bed. And just kind of flop down and say, man, I'm home. I'm home. That's the way we want to be with God. That's the way God wants us to be with Him. Come into His presence and come into that place. Even though you're tired, even though you're weary from the journey and weary from the battles and weary from the work that you're doing for Him, sometimes you get to the point, God, I just need a break. I want to rest a little while.
Yes, sir.
He said, come on. Come on. Sometimes we get to that place. We just get to that place. And I found so many times that when you get to that place, that's when you need to find that alone time. Lock yourself in the closet. Lock yourself in the bathroom. You know, just find your way. And nothing else, go get in the car and go somewhere and park out in the middle of a parking lot and just lock the door. Turn you on some good praise and worship music and just sit there and enjoy the presence of God.
Amen.
Amen. Have you ever wanted to do that, or have you ever done that? And I do it every once in a while. I just find me a parking lot somewhere, find me a shade tree to park under, and I'll roll the windows up, turn the air conditioner on, turn on some good praise and worship music. I just lean back in the seat, and I just start thinking about Jesus. I just start thinking about heaven. Woo! I just think about God's glory and enjoying His presence for a little while. And it'll do something to you. It'll rejuvenate you. How's he going to give you rest? First of all, he said in verse 29, he said, take my yoke upon you. That's the obligation that Christ expects out of us, to take his yoke. His yoke is not heavy. His yoke is relatively easy to bear. Amen? And part of what he's talking about, he said, just learn of me. Learn of me. Take the opportunity. Take the time to pick up your Bible and read it. And if you're out working or driving or you travel a lot, you know, you can get cassettes and CDs with the Bible on it. And then pop that tape or that CD in there and listen to the Word of God. There's so much joy in listening to the Word. I try to encourage my granddaughter. She struggles with math the same way both my girls did. And you know, I think it's an inherited thing. They just don't want to do it. But I was the same way. But I eventually learned it. And now they come to me, but Papa, I just don't understand this. I can't figure it out.
Now, I have heard you present the problem. Now I can help you with the problem. And I'll look the square and I'll make her look at me. And when you make them look at you, they remember better. I said, remember this, and this is biblical. I'm going to tell my 12-year-old granddaughter, this is biblical. The Holy Spirit will give you remembrance of all things that you've seen and heard. I said, so young lady, if you will read it out loud, you are looking at it, but you're also hearing yourself read it. And when she reads them out loud, she understands better what she's reading and what she's doing. It's no different with the Word of God. Many of us will sit and read the Word to ourselves without making a sound. Are we ashamed somebody might hear us? Well, maybe not. But I have found, if you want to really enjoy the Word of God, read it out loud.
Amen.
Not only are you seeing it with your own eyes, but you're hearing yourself read it. The devil's hearing you read it. And that scares you to death, because he really knows the Word better than you do. But God the Father is hearing the Word that you're reading. And he's proud of the fact that you're reading his word out loud for everybody to hear. And he's promised in his word that his spirit would give you the remembrance of all things that you've seen and heard. Reading the word out loud will cause you to remember it better. And when you use God's word against the enemy, God will stand up and say, yes, this is what you need at this very moment. And I'm going to send it to you. It's going to come out your brain, and it'll come out through your mouth, and it'll be power and glory in the Lord Jesus Christ, and you can be more effective every day.
Praise God.
That's part of taking his yoke upon you. Be willing to submit yourself every day to him. Now, stop and think what a yoke is. It was a piece of wood that was carved and framed to fit around the neck of an ox or a mule or something like that. And it was designed for pulling and bearing a load. Well, human beings figured out, before they had the animals, they made yokes for themselves where they could pick up two big buckets of water or two big baskets. You know, they looked like a scale walking down the road, sitting there swinging back and forth. But they would design that thing so that it would be comfortable on their shoulders and not be burdensome to them, and they could carry much more. Now, realize, if you're carrying your load that way, every once in a while, you've got to stop and take a break. Every once in a while, you just have to rest. So you set it all down, and maybe you squat down or sit down on a tree stump or something and take a little break. Give your shoulders rest, your back, your legs, and all that. But to realize, Jesus said, take my yoke upon me. He said, when you reach down and you start to pick that yoke up that belongs to the Lord that he's wanting you to carry, do you realize that Jesus is right behind you and he's the one picking the yoke up? He's the one putting the yoke on his shoulders. He's the one that's carrying the load. And all he's doing is say, just walk right in front of him and we'll get there together. You ever think about that? He's carrying that load for you. But so many times we want to reach up and try to help God. Oh, me, oh, my. We want to try to help Jesus carry that load. He don't need our help. But we don't want to get too big-headed and too strong-willed that we walk away from him.
Mm-hmm.
Thinking that, well, he's got the load, that means I can travel on. No, don't do that. Take the opportunity to learn, spend time in prayer, read his word, be around fellow believers. You know, one of the biggest encouragements and one of the biggest things I find to get a spiritual break and a spiritual rest is just to be around fellow believers. You can hear so much encouragement. Every once in a while you hear something that maybe kind of discourages you just a little bit. But you know, praise God, I want to pray for them. I want to bless them. I want God to bless them. I want to lift them up in prayer. And all of a sudden, you start hearing praise reports. Man, you know, we give so many prayer needs. We need to start giving more praise reports.
Yeah.
Amen. Let the devil get it in the eye, left and right. Amen. I want to hear more praise reports.
Yeah.
Amen. Praise God. I want to hear more praise reports. I'm born again by the blood of Jesus. yoke upon you, for I am meek and lowly of heart.
He's humble, but yet he's strong. In that situation, we're acquainted with Jesus Christ. We're acquainted with the eternal life that he's promised us. We get relief from all the fatigue. Many times that fatigue will just wear you down. You just keep going, you get a little bit of rest, you just keep going, get a little bit of rest, you keep going, get a little bit of rest, keep going, get a little bit of rest. After a while, you're not getting enough rest breaks and too much work breaks. And after a while, you get fatigued down. The gas company came up with a brilliant idea. Our crew bosses have the right and the authority. They can call for what they call micro breaks. Micro breaks. You know, normally on your job, you get to work 2 hours, you get a 10 or 15 minute break, and then you work 2 hours, and you get your lunch break or another long break, and then you work a couple more hours and get another break. But we can do it. Our crew leaders and our crew foremen, they have the right. They can just shout out at any time, micro break! And when you hear micro break, you can just drop everything you're doing. Run and get you a bottle of water. Go sit down in the shade. Problem is, though, about the time you sit down and drink some water, they say, break's over, back to work. You know, I asked a minute or two. One of them hollered that one day, and I turned around and looked at him, I said, micro break your eye. He said, we're going to take a micro break. He said, get in the shade. I said, what about you? When you go get in the sun? You've been in the shade all day. Well, you take a break and get in the shade, and I'll go get in the sun. So he stood in the sun and drank his bottle of water. And I stood in the shade. But sometimes the micro breaks, I told him one day, I said, we need to add about 10 of those micro breaks together. I said, instead of 10 micro breaks, let's just have one good break. He said, what are you going to do? I said, I'm going to go over and lay down in the grass for a few minutes. And I did. I just went over and I laid down on the ground. He said, you're crazy. I said, no, I'm not. I said, why you can't call me crazy? He said, look how you're laying. I said, I'm laying on the ground. I'm relaxed. He said, but your head is down the hill and your feet are pointing up. He said, shouldn't you be turning the other way? I said, no, if I lay this way, more good oxygen-rich blood gets to my brain. And I said, it's got to rejuvenate my brain before the rest of my body gets rejuvenated. And he stood there and I said, that's so I can put up with your ignorance. And it's the same way dealing, it sounds funny, but it's the truth. It's the same way dealing with the devil. Let the Holy Spirit rejuvenate your spirit man inside. Rejuvenate your brain and your soul. The body may be weak, but the spirit will be strong. And when the devil comes around, hey, devil, physically, I'm exhausted. But spiritually, I can put up with your nonsense with no trouble. Because the power of the Holy Spirit has allowed me to rest and rejuvenate in God, the giver of life, the giver of my joy, the giver of my strength. Amen. And you're not going to be able to win over me.
Amen.
Just letting the devil know where he needs to be. Amen. All that through the relief of the fatigue, the heavy burdens, that rest for your soul. Rest for your mind, rest for your physical body, receiving the truth and the wisdom of God so that you can use it as knowledge and power against the enemy. The more you know about God, the more you know about his word, the better you can fight the enemy. Amen. Don't be confused with the things of this world, but allow the Spirit of God to work in you and through you. Through this, you find rest for your soul, you find rest for your body, you find rest for your mind. Amen. End result is you got rest for your soul. Verse 30, he said, for my yoke is easy. My yoke is easy and my burden is mine. You know, in Galatians chapter 5, verse 1, he said, stand fast therefore in the liberty with which God, with Christ, had made us free. and not be entangled again with the yoke of bondage. And Jesus is talking more so in chapter 11 of Matthew. He's talking more so about the dogmatic or the dogma or the craziness of the religious community. The religious community. Some of us have been through that in such a way that, I got saved this morning. Well, did you get baptized this morning too? Well, no. Well, then you're not saved. We hear that. That's real. That goes on in churches. Or if you don't do this, or if you don't do that, or if you've got to have this, or you've got to have that. They just like the days when the Pharisees were dealing with Jesus, they start tacking all this other junk onto the Mosaic law that you got to do all this stuff to be holy before the Lord. Jesus plainly said, trust in me, call on me, and he said, I'll save your soul.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. It's pretty simple. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe in him, amen, would not perish but have everlasting life. Believing in Jesus, believing on the name of Jesus, calling on him and asking him to forgive you. Hey, how much more simplistic can it be?
Amen.
But everybody wants to tack all this junk on there.
Yes, amen.
Well, you can't be saved. You got baptized wrong, or you didn't get baptized at all, or you went to the wrong church, or you're reading out the wrong version of the Bible. I just want to get a little rubber mallet out and just poke people on the forehead. Brother Richard probably felt the same way. You know.
Instead of having a rubber on you, I'll get a steel.
Wood works better.
Steel will fix stupid.
Steel fix stupid? Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. I got a good one at the work. It's a big 4-pound steel shop hammer. See how good it works on some of them knotheads. Think about rubber mounted, don't bruise as bad. Don't leave bruises. You ladies, if you've got an unruly husband, you use a skillet or a roll pin, be sure to wrap a towel around it. That way you don't leave bruises. Trust me. I ain't got a bruise on me nowhere, but I can't hardly walk the time. I got a wife that loves me. She shows it all the time. Straighten up! Boom! My yoke is easy and my burden is light. Psalm 55:22, he says, cast thy burden upon the Lord, and he shall sustain thee. He shall never suffer or never cause the righteous to be moved. Through the power of God and the power of the Spirit and the authority of his word, there's no reason that we should get so bent out of shape that we ain't figured out which way to go to get out the front door. And I have met people that would call and say, I'm so just tore up, I don't know which way to go. Well, get out the front door and go stand on the front porch. Breathe some fresh air. Maybe that'll help. Oh, I just don't know what to do. Go stand on the front door. When you get to a place that you don't know what to do, you don't know which way to go, and I'm going to challenge you with this. And most of you know I ain't got enough sense heart to get out of the rain. But that's the way God built me. And he loves me just like I am. And he's blessed me just like I am. Because I ain't got no better sense than to take God at his word. And he said, you shall, or you shall not. And he said, I will. Or I will not. Just step out on the porch and just start saying the name of Jesus. You don't have to scream and holler. Just step out on the porch in the middle of the night, early in the morning, whatever it may be. Just step out on the porch and just say the name of Jesus. Just say the name of Jesus. Everybody says it a little different. Everybody says it maybe in a different form or fashion. I said, I fall in love with God more and more every day.
I said, they're coming over my eyes and get up and go to work. I said, I just fall in love with God for me. Because he displaces people. And sometimes I'll just step out on the back porch and I'll just stand there for him. I don't have to give up. I don't have to cry. I just look up to Jesus. Because he promised, I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you.
Amen.
He said, I'll be with you even to the very end of this world. Yes. I have known that. And I know on a daily basis, I come to him every day. I bring my burdens to him. Yes. I bring that toil and that labor. I said, Lord, I've carried this all day. When I've picked it up along the way, you know, I need some rest to stay in that drive.
Right.
The Lord has never failed. Come unto me.
Yes.
And I'll be with you.
Amen.
Yes.
That's
right. I'm going to testify.
Right. Oh, come on, testify.
Oh.
Everybody from Patrick died.
Jesus.
And he died in April, but it was like his birthday was in March, but it was like February. And I'm sitting there, curse my Lord God. I cannot live. I cannot live another day knowing Patrick's birthday is coming. And he said to me, just like I'm talking, he said, Barbara, I will take your grief if you will give it to me.
Right.
And I said, I give it to you.
Right.
And it was locked. Everything was gone.
Oh,
and everything was gone. And it's been gone, but still he's with me constantly.
Amen.
God is, because I know God. Anyway,
praise
God.
Amen.
Thank you,
Jesus.
When he takes your burdens. Yes. Never, never, never brings it back to you and say, say I'm tired of hating my time, so you get it. No, it
Thank you.